Welcome back to the Castlevania Marathon, and happy Halloween! This marathon was supposed to end today, but a thing I like to call life happened, so I apologize for the delay. Last episode I took a look at Castlevania II Simon's Quest. It really set itself apart from the original, going for a more adventure and exploration design instead of the linear, level-based design of the previous entry. The game itself was a cool concept, just not executed well. Cryptic puzzles, constant grinding, annoying mechanics, it was lazy. It wasn't designed well, and I didn't enjoy it too much. With every weird sequel there was on the NES, people either disliked the game or thought it was okay, and I think companies realized that back in the day. Whenever they would experiment too much with their sequels, fans wouldn't like it as much as they did the first one. So with a lot of these franchises, you'll see them go back to the original format, but expand upon it in a way that's both original and different, but still keeping that original feel the original game had. Just look at Super Mario Bros. 3. It was fun, addicting, and different. It based its gameplay off the first one, but expanded upon that in many ways, adding more items, enemies, levels, level themes, bosses, you name it. Same with Zelda. A Link to the Past is a top-down view, just like the first one, but it takes the core gameplay and expands upon it in hundreds of ways. And finally, Castlevania. Castlevania 3 takes the original platform design of the first one and expands upon it, adding more levels, enemies, bosses, and more mechanics that we'll get to in a bit. So you could say this is the true sequel to Castlevania. Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse was released in North America on September 1st, 1990. It was praised for going back to the original format of Castlevania. Whipping ghouls, collecting flashing orbs, using sub-weapons, fighting bosses. It's your typical action-packed horror-themed platformer. Not only was it praised for going back to the roots of Castlevania, but it also made improvements compared to the previous entries. It's a breath of fresh air after playing Simon's Quest. No cryptic puzzles, no walkthroughs, no grinding, just whipping monsters with a simple objective. Castlevania in all its glory. So let's take a look at the true sequel to Castlevania, Castlevania 3, Dracula's Curse. Okay, first things first. The story takes place in the year 1476, actually making this a prequel. Count Dracula and his army of monsters is attacking Europe, and of course the Belmont family are called to help. So to save Europe, you must travel to Dracula's castle, defeat his army of monsters, and defeat him once again. Yes, again, I don't know how many times we have to kill Dracula, but can't we have a different villain other than Dracula? Never mind. You play the role as Trevor Belmont, another member of the Belmont clan. He's very similar to Simon, only he has a headband, which makes him cooler. First thing you'll notice when you start the game is the graphical upgrade this game has. Just by looking at the opening cutscene shows they stepped up their game when it came to the graphics, and we'll talk about that later. The gameplay is Castlevania at its finest. Literally everything's the same. The delay in the whip, the level-based design, the items, the chicken in the walls. You know this game? Yeah, essentially this game is exactly that, but more. There's 15 stages total, each one having a unique boss to fight at the end, just like the first one. But unlike the first Castlevania, this game isn't strictly linear. Along the way to Dracula's castle, there'll be different pathways leading to different stages. You're given a choice on which one to take, and depending on which one you'll choose, it will switch up the way to get to Dracula's castle, and actually the ending of the game. This adds a lot of replay value to the game. There's like three different routes to Dracula's castle, and each one of them is a completely new experience with different levels, enemies, and bosses. Not only that, but also along the way you'll find certain characters that will join your party and help you out on your journey. Finding these characters also depend on which path you take, making it even more replayable. There's three characters, Grant, Sypha, and Alucard. Every single one has unique abilities, items, and different playstyles. You can only have one in your party at a time, so when you find another character, you can either keep the one you have, or switch it out for a new member. You can switch between these characters at any time by pressing select, but I didn't find myself using them that much. Don't get me wrong, it's a cool mechanic, but I never felt like they were useful. But then again, most of the time I forgot I had them, so I didn't use them enough to really see if they were useful or not. With the amount of content put into this game, it just shows that this game really pushed the NES's limits. And you can tell, in every stage the environments look a lot more clean, adding detailed and moving backgrounds to enhance that horror atmosphere. The level design adds more environment hazards, like rotating gears or swaying pendulums in a giant clock. So instead of just using enemies as hazards, the game throws in platforming hazards as well. Now you would think these sections would be difficult with being less mobile in the air, and they are, but the platforming mechanics in this game feel cleaner and more polished compared to the original. Yes, I struggled with some of these parts, but the jumping for some reason still felt a lot smoother than the previous game, so it wasn't as big of a problem as I thought it would be. But the knockback is still a huge issue for me. Not only that, but even the level design sets you up for knockback traps constantly. I mean, yeah, the first one did it a couple times too, but I found myself running into scenarios where the enemies are set up in ways to easily knock you off the ledge. I look at this as annoying level design, but I guess you can also look at it as well thought out design, but honestly, you can look at it either way. The sub-weapons still act the same. You got your exact same variety of weapons to use from the first Castlevania. The hearts are used as ammo, and some levels have you using them strategically in certain situations. Typical Castlevania design. One thing that really surprised me was the sheer amount of variety in this game. From the different characters to use, to all the original enemies, to every single boss in the game, you're constantly being introduced to new things. And it's not like this game is short either. It's a long game with a lot of replay value. Once you beat the game, you can go on a different route, and it's a whole new experience. The variety is huge, and that's one of the strongest points this game has. Now, when it comes to difficulty, the first Castlevania is a cakewalk compared to this one. Some levels would take me an hour to beat. Like I mentioned before, a lot of levels added environment hazards and what I call knockback traps. There are also more annoying enemies. These flying dragon things, the hunchbacks make a return, flying Medusa heads, and these freaking vultures, I can't stand them. It seems like the developers made more annoying enemies to complement the frustrating level design. Take for example this giant staircase with these dragon things flying up and down and these statue things that are firing projectiles at the same time. And that's just one scenario. It really puts your Castlevania skills to the test. Thankfully, for every Castlevania, you have unlimited continues. At the end of every stage, there's an original boss, and they did not disappoint. Each boss has a set of unique attacks and more complex patterns. With the first Castlevania, the bosses kind of just moved back and forth or flew around the room throwing projectiles. In this game, they're climbing on walls, springing out of the water, making bricks crumble on top of you. In the first Castlevania, I mentioned most bosses lacked originality, but that's not the case with this game. They took a big step in the right direction. There were a couple bosses that gave me some hassles, like the two dragons and the evil clone, but other than that, they were all decently challenging. After all the frustrating and challenging stages, I finally made it to the final boss. And just like the first one, there's a giant staircase leading up to Dracula. I still love the suspense this adds. It's always exciting to me to see what Dracula looks in all these games. We've went from stereotypical Dracula to ginormous skeleton Dracula, and now a magic mage Dracula. Okay? The final boss is what you'd expect from a Castlevania by now. Right as you walk in, you see Dracula on his throne waiting for your arrival. And just like that, the battle begins. He starts off by trapping you with two pillars of fire and striking the third pillar wherever you're standing. It took me a couple attempts to get his pattern down, but once you do, it's pretty simple. If you've played the first game, you'll know that you aren't finished yet. So once you defeat his first phase, he explodes and turns into a five-headed barfing brain. I don't even know what to say at this point. He just floats around, barfing acid on the ground. He's easy to kill. After that, out of nowhere, Dracula turns into this giant laser-firing bird. Again, I don't know what to say. The way you defeat him is by jumping on these platforms and whip his head to deal damage to him. Well, that's what you're supposed to do. I, on the other hand, used the axe weapon and kind of just stood on one side and killed him. Honestly, the last form is probably the easiest. The lasers are slow enough to dodge easy, and if you have the axe power, you really don't need to move all that much. So just like that, I beat Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse. With the third entry in the Castlevania series, you're kind of getting the best of both worlds from the previous games. You get the platforming level-by-level design of the first game, and the more serious graphics and atmosphere from the second. The environments are still dark and horror-themed, but you still have that color and contrast from the first game. It was nice to see them go back to original form with this game, but also add a little non-linearity, kind of like Simon's Quest. I really enjoyed this game, from the fantastic graphics to the satisfaction of beating it to the amazing soundtrack. Castlevania 3 was the ultimate sequel slash prequel to the Castlevania series, and was a great ending to the NES trilogy. We wouldn't see the next entry in the series in North America until December 4th, 1991, with the release of Super Castlevania 4. And this is when the series gets the super treatment on the Super Nintendo. So tune in, hopefully next week, in the finale in this Castlevania Marathon, where I'll be taking a look at Super Castlevania 4.